Hi everyone, welcome to our Monday live stream. It's great to have you here. It's been a couple of weeks since we live streamed. We had a really big car issue last week we had to get taken care of. So at the very last minute, we had to postpone the live stream and put it off until this week. But welcome, happy Monday. It's a very hot day here today. We're finally getting into our hot summer. Yesterday, I think it hit probably close to 100. Today in the 90s, and the next several days, it's gonna be in the 90s, maybe close to 100. So glad you're joining me today. I know it's hot all over the US right now. We've had crazy hot temperatures this summer. And today's topic is all about what to do in the garden in August. So it's crazy enough, the summer is actually winding down, at least for a lot of people. And man, it just seemed like yesterday we were in the midst of wintertime approaching spring. And here it is getting to the end of summer. So just crazy. So we're gonna go over a lot of things that you can do in your garden in August because the growing season is not yet over. So if it's your very first time joining us, thank you so much for being here. And we do have several first time live streamers. We really appreciate you setting aside your time on a Monday to hang out with us here. We have a lot of fun. We're live most Mondays at 12 o'clock at noon Pacific time. So just mark your calendar, invite your friends to join us. We have a great time sharing garden tips, support, encouragement. If you're discouraged, which I know a few people in the chat ahead of time mentioned that they are, you're in the right place. Lots of tips and encouragement flying around everywhere, not just from me, but from all the wonderful gardeners that are with us week after week. So that being said, let's say hello, see who's here today. Luz is always here almost every single Monday, as is Patricia P. Treadway. Thank you so much for hanging out. Garden Obsessions, great to have you here. I know you join us whenever you can, so I'm so glad you could be here today. Erica Lewis, great to see you. Terry, Angela, Debbie from Hawaii. Aloha, Debbie. Great to have you on here today. Tim is a new live streamer today, Tim Clefman. So happy that you're here. Been watching our videos for a year or so. Really appreciate that, Tim. My backyard gourds, cooler summer this year. That's great. You are very lucky about that because a lot of people are having really, really hot summers. Miriam, great to have you here again today. Yolanda, I think. Wanda, sorry, my computer screen or my iPad screen just dimmed for a second there. Great to have you. Sansi, wonderful. I'm so glad that you could catch us live. Allie and Deanna from Georgia Zone 8A. Great to have you on here today. So hope everybody had a great weekend. Let's jump in and talk about the first thing on my list, what to do in August. You might be feeling overwhelmed, wondering what exactly am I supposed to be doing in the garden this month. These are just a few of my favorites that I like to try and include at some point during the month. So you can kind of pick and choose what works for you. Don't want anybody getting overwhelmed and burnt out, but maybe pick one of these, one or two of them to do during the month. But basically I picked my top four I think I have on the list. And the first one relates very well to what we were talking about in the pre-chat live stream. And by the way, I'm here about 15 minutes early every week. My wonderful moderators, Cliff and Nisha, by the way, Cliff, welcome back from vacation, are here about a half hour ahead of time. So join in the fun if you're able to before the live stream even starts. Okay, so first thing in August is be on the alert. There's lots of things going on in the garden. The heat, number one, is crazy. You might have critters, you know, marching their way through your garden because your vegetables are getting ready to harvest or in the middle of harvesting them, and they seem to know exactly when they get ripe, don't you think? But probably the biggest thing, one of the biggest things people are dealing with at this point in the season is insects. If you haven't yet, you might be dealing with all of those things, the heat, the critters, the insects, and probably the disease that might come marching through your garden here in August. So be on the lookout for that. So let's talk about a couple of those off the bat. With the heat and the humidity, I know a lot of you live in humid climates. We've actually had a lot more humidity this summer than we normally have just because of the marine layer we've been having. Brings in some of the mugginess. But with the heat and the humidity, oftentimes comes diseases. Most of you are probably familiar with powdery mildew. It's kind of that powdery looking substance that can coat the leaves, often in squash, cucumbers. Zinnias tend to be really prone to powdery mildew, and it can really hit just about any plant, tomatoes. It can spread like wildfire through your garden. So you really do have to keep an eye out for that. That's probably the most prevalent disease. Tomato blight often comes through this time of the year as well. So kind of my general rule of thumb on dealing with disease is, first off the bat, take off or prune off any leaves that you see that might not look so great, that are spotted, yellowing, just old leaves that are on the bottom of maybe your squash plants or your cucumber plants. Just take them off. Anything with powdery mildew, take it off. Those diseases really do spread quickly. So the sooner you can get them pruned off your plants and tossed in the green bin — we have a green bin here in California, where we toss all of our green waste — you don't want to put that in your compost, because you don't want that spreading through your compost to other parts of your garden. So I always toss it in the green bin. It gets taken out once a week. Just get it off. Now, a couple of different ways that you can deal with the really common, like the powdery mildew, is a milk water spray. Most everyone has some type of milk in your refrigerator. It does not have to be cow's milk. So I know a lot of people are allergic to that, or intolerant, lactose intolerant. It really just needs to be a milk that has a protein in it. It's the protein in the milk that mixes together with the sunlight. You want to spray it in sunlight. And generally the ratio I use, it's really simple, is 8 or 9 parts of water, doesn't have to be exact, to about 1 part of milk. So for example, if it's 9 cups of water, if you're spraying it like in a big, you know, gallon sprayer, 9 cups of water to 1 part milk, shake it up, and then just go around and spray the plants that might be affected, or plants that you want to kind of control that powdery mildew. And it's something about the milk with the sunlight that helps with the powdery mildew. So I'm not sure exactly what that is, but it really does seem to work. It helps control it. It's not always gonna get rid of it, but it does help control it. So give that a try. Got a video on that. You can just look up powdery mildew on my YouTube channel. There's that little magnifying glass on the front page of our channel. And if you click on that, that's a little search bar. You can type the topic or the vegetable, whatever it is you have a question on, and it'll pull up a YouTube video on that topic. So it's a great way to get your questions answered. I'm not always able to get back to everyone via email or comments, but you can often find the answer yourself right on our channel. As far as tomato diseases go, we don't have tons of issues with heavy tomato diseases here, but I do clip off anything that's yellowing. I know a lot of people use a hydrogen peroxide spray. I know Gary at the Rustic Garden uses that to help with tomato diseases. So go over and check out his YouTube channel for a video on that. But the first things first is I tend to keep mine pruned. It usually starts from the bottom and works its way up. If you are getting diseases in your garden, it's not your fault. It just pretty much happens at this time of the year. Just expect it and learn to manage your expectations. Oftentimes it's easier to start over with some new seedlings or new transplants than to try and go all out and save a plant that might have some issues. So that's the first thing, is diseases. Let's move a little bit more into the pests now, because there were some questions about that earlier. A very common pest here and in most gardens is aphids. But there's all kinds of, you know, cucumber beetles, tomato hornworms, there's all kinds of things out there. The biggest and best thing you can do for your garden is just keep an eye on it daily. So head out in the morning, not in the heat of the day where you're gonna get dehydrated. The morning or the evening is usually when I do my quick little garden checks, and see if there's any pest problems that you need to address right away. The first thing what I usually do is, if I have like an aphid infestation, they can quickly get out of control. So I'll just like spray it down with water just to wash all those bugs off. That goes for aphids, spider mites. The worms are not so easy to wash off because they tend to cling on. The little cabbage loopers or the tomato hornworms like to grab onto the leaves and they don't like to let go. But it'll generally work pretty well if you can catch it up front. For aphids, even a pretty good aphid infestation, several days of rinsing your plant off with water a lot of times will do the trick. Spider mites are a little bit trickier. But a really easy organic pest control that you can use for those bugs that do chew on the leaves or suck the sap out of your plants is you can use a neem oil, organic neem oil pest spray. And I have a video on that, so go check that out. Just look up organic pest control, you'll find it. But you always want to do a test spray first. Now I know, I'm sorry, I can't remember your name, who was in the pre-chat, you were talking about how you were afraid to use neem oil. You make a solution, which is in the video, and you always want to test spray your plants first. So don't douse your whole garden down or your whole plant down. Do a small little portion of your plant, a couple of leaves, test spray it, and then wait 24 to 48 hours and see how your plant does. And then if it has any damage, you do want to make some adjustments, lower the ratio of the neem oil and of the soap that you're putting in. The soap helps it stick to the plant. You're mixing with water, neem oil, and then a little bit of dish soap or like a natural type of Castile soap or something like that. And you do want to spray in the morning before the bee activity is out. Try not to spray flowers directly. You don't want to, you know, spray the bees directly, but it will harm the little creepy crawlies that are chewing on your leaves of your plant. So that includes aphids. That includes spider mites. So check that video out for all the details. And as far as the frequency goes, infestation, you want to spray every 3 days or so. Just kind of as a general maintenance, you could give it a spray once a week. That will help with prevention and help them from even coming to the plant. And the peppermint oil is what I put in that kind of helps them. It kind of masks the smell of the plant, so it'll help deter the pests from attacking your plant. So that's just a little quick rundown of the pests, diseases. The critters are a whole different thing. Let me just show you some of my favorite critter deterrents that I like to use, because they don't always respond to sprays. Granules, sometimes they will, and sprays, but you do have to be really, really consistent if you're spraying anything for the critters. Like a hot pepper spray will work pretty well. There's some other types of granules out there that do work fairly well. There's no guarantees, as in anything with gardening. Eventually something will get your plant at some point, so just be prepared for that. But a couple little things that can help. These little net bags are pretty handy. They're fairly inexpensive. I get them on Amazon. I think I just took it off a tomato. It's still got some straw in it. And these do help if you can put them over your tomatoes. It just kind of deters the pests. It's one more thing they have to chew through. There are some animals that are quite persistent and it won't keep them out, but it's something to try. Another thing that I do like to use too are just pieces of old t-shirt. This is an old t-shirt that I wasn't wearing anymore, so I cut up pieces and strips of it. You might have seen it on my Instagram a few weeks ago. Excuse me, and that really helps. Ooh, it's hot out here. That really helps provide a little bit of a barrier. And then one thing you could also do, say you have like a tomato cage or a garden bed that the squirrels might be visiting, or the squirrels or the rats might be visiting. This might keep out squirrels a little bit more than rats, but you could wrap your like your tomato cage or your garden bed, you know, fairly tightly in something like this, and just clip it around the bottom, and hopefully it will help deter the critters from getting up in there and grabbing your produce. So I know it can be really discouraging if it happens often, but hang in there. Try a couple of these things, and get out there, and you can even harvest your tomatoes a little bit early, to right when they start to blush just a little bit, and put them on the counter. I mean, I know you really might want to vine ripen your tomatoes, but it's better to have tomatoes that aren't vine ripened and you can finish ripening them in the house than to have no tomatoes at all. So try a couple of these things. And the great thing about this community is there's so many people offering suggestions and comments in the chat. Everyone works together. And that's one thing I love, is that all the encouragement and support is not just coming from me, but it's coming from all of you too as well. So that's always great for me to see. It's very, very heartwarming to see. Okay, let me head into the chat here and see what questions we have. I'm sure this brought up a lot of questions because so many people are dealing with it. And I'm sorry, because of the brightness today, my screen kind of dims, so it's a little bit difficult to see. I might be able to see it easier on my computer, which is right in front of me. So let me take a look here. M. Martinez says, I love the combo of a few drops of dish soap, a tablespoon of vegetable oil, and a tablespoon of baking soda to a gallon of water for powdery mildew. So great suggestion, M. Martinez. Baking soda, I've heard, works really well for powdery mildew. So try that, see if it works for you in your area. But again, always test spray. And also keep in mind that vegetables or sprays respond differently in different temperatures. So if you're having a heat wave, you do want to even test spray again, a spray that you might have used earlier in the season during cooler temperatures. So I just, whenever I'm trying anything new or whenever we have a heat wave or whatever, I just kind of, as a general rule of thumb, get out there and do a little test spray just to be on the safe side. Okay, CG's in the chat, camera guy's in the chat. Most of you know he's working full-time for Callie Kim, a garden for our business now. So it's great to have all of his assistance with a live stream set up. We've been able to film more content, and he's working on a ton of really fun projects that we have coming up in the very near future. So always great to have him on here. So I'm glad you guys are enjoying that too. Okay, Ramona says, yellow leaves on squash and grapes, help. Yeah, some type of a disease probably is attacking your squash and your grapes, Ramona. So, you know, go ahead and just take those leaves off. As a general rule of thumb, anything that's yellowing, dry, which could be a scorched, leaf from the heat, just go ahead and clip those off, because you don't want your plant to be putting all of its energy into keeping those dead or dying or diseased leaves alive. You want your plant to put all of its energy into producing lots of great vegetables for you to harvest, even here in the late summer and into the fall. So just take those off. And if it spreads and starts to be a bigger issue, you might have to spray it with something. But at this point in time, just go ahead and prune it off here. Okay, Tim, first timer here. Thanks, Tim. My tomatoes seem to have some sort of bright yellow substance on them that comes off and stains my hands, clothes, etc. Anyone know what this is? Could it be just pollen? Okay, a lot of times when you touch tomatoes, you have like that tomato smell on your hands. I love that smell, and you might get kind of some brown substance on your hands. That's perfectly normal. Yellow substance is probably some type of a pollen, maybe just from the flowers that's kind of falling onto your tomatoes, but perfectly normal. It doesn't sound like it's any type of issue that you need to be concerned about. So don't worry about that. But again, if you see those yellowing leaves, go ahead and take them out. And Jen, great question here. What is the best time of day to prune those dead leaves when the weather is so hot? It really doesn't matter as far as pruning in the heat. I mean, in my opinion though, you shouldn't be out in the middle of the day when it's hot like this. I have a very low tolerance to temperatures over 90 degrees in the heat. I don't want to get dehydrated. I don't want to get heat stroke. So do yourself a favor, and probably your plants a favor too, actually. In the middle of the day, they're a little bit more stressed. So just get out there first thing in the morning. I'm usually up before the sun, or in the evening during the golden hour after the sun's kind of set, is a really pleasant time to be in the garden. So go for that if that time of the day works for you too. Okay, let's jump into our next tip here, you guys. And that would be number two, and hopefully you all are doing this now, is reap the rewards of growing your vegetable garden. Grow it, harvest it, eat it. Now's the time when a lot of the tomatoes are ripening, the cucumbers are ripening, even maybe the watermelon. We've done lots of harvest videos lately. And by the way, did you guys enjoy that video we did over the weekend with the cucumber tomato harvest? We had a crazy amount of tomatoes and cucumbers, and camera guy and I got out there and harvested. It was so much fun, and we made a really delicious tomato cucumber salad. It was so good, and we're just actually finishing up the rest yesterday, and I think we have a little bit left for lunch today. So if you haven't caught that video, go back and watch it. We're really trying to make quick and easy things out of our garden grocery store. That way we can eat them all. I'm not a huge, I don't get too complicated in the kitchen. I try and keep it simple. So if you like that video, make sure you let us know. We added different things to it. Some protein, white beans, chicken. We did a couple different variations. So let us know if you enjoyed that video. It was really, really fun. But don't forget to get out there and harvest. I know it kind of sounds crazy, but we get busy, right? We're working, and sometimes we're like, oh, I gotta get out to the garden. But the more you harvest, the more your garden is gonna give back. So now's the time to reap the rewards. You've been working hard all spring, all summer, and get out there daily and check your garden, especially with certain vegetables like beans, like squash. The more you pick it, the more you're gonna produce, the more they're gonna produce. So when you're letting your vegetables stay too long on the plant, it kind of sends a signal to the plant that it's kind of done for the season, and your plant, your veggies might get oversized, and it kind of goes into like maybe even seed production mode. Like the green beans will dry up. You can harvest the seeds, and if that's something that you want to do, then more power to you. But if you want to grow it for the dinner, for the garden to table experience and meals, get out there and harvest something every single day. So I want to show you a couple of things that I harvested this morning. And it was so much fun just to kind of wander through the garden and see what I had. This beautiful eggplant. I have a black beauty plant that probably has, it's right down there, probably has 10 eggplant just like this. So went out and picked one this morning. Maybe we'll grill it up for dinner tonight or make a little eggplant dish out of it. Something we've that are actually been harvesting a little bit slower than I anticipated is the passion fruit. They have been like dropping to the ground, which actually is a sign that they're ripe when they fall right off the vine. But we've been eating these almost every day. Look at these, you guys. Aren't these beautiful? They're kind of a tart type of fruit. It's pretty juicy on the inside, kind of a gel-like substance. The seeds are edible, kind of like a pomegranate seed. They're kind of crunchy. They're delicious. So I've just been scooping them right out of the shell and eating them for breakfast just like this. So that's really fun. I found this a little bit oversized scallop squash this morning. It likes to hide under the vines, but it's really fun to slice these up. They're so pretty on the grill. Then a couple more things from the garden grocery store this morning. A pepper, and I forgot the variety of this. I'm not sure, I'll have to look at my tag. And then a couple more passion fruit. So just see what you have in your garden grocery store and then eat it. Eat what's in season, eat what you have on hand, and get creative. You don't have to be overly complicated with it. The grilling is super, super easy, and you can also roast them in the oven if you don't have a grill, or just eat them fresh and chop your tomatoes and cucumbers into a salad. We have that probably almost every day with some type of variation on it. So, and you know, you can always use your leftovers that you have in the refrigerator, like chopped up chicken, to add a little bit more substance to your salads. But grow it, harvest it, and eat it. Tons of herbs too. We have lots and lots of herbs coming on, which always add some great flavor either to your beverages or to your salads as well. So let me know in the chat here what you're harvesting, if you harvested anything this weekend, or what you have outside to run out and harvest today and what you're gonna make from it. It's always great to have new, fresh ideas. Okay, let's see in the chat here what's going on. And yeah, it is a really big scallop squash, Debbie. And that one probably will be a little bit on the seedy side. But if you watched our garden to table grilling video, you saw that I just kind of cut around the seeds, cut the seeds out, no big deal. Or you can dry the seeds like on a piece of parchment paper on a cookie tray. That is an heirloom variety, so you can save those seeds for next time you plant. But it makes it really, really fun. Okay, let's see what you're harvesting today in your garden. And my potatoes are burning. What to do? Yes, shade cloth would be very helpful in that situation. And I forgot to mention that in the heat portion of the video, or in the heat portion of our live stream today, is definitely be getting your shade cloth out right now, especially with these hot temps. If you're gonna have a day, a full-on day where it's in the mid-90s to 100s, you're gonna wanna cover some of your special vegetables so that they don't, the blossoms don't dry up and drop off. And then you're kind of left with, I gotta start over with you know, my tomatoes because all my blossoms just dried up. So give that a try too. Okay, Tina says, I'm growing purple cabbage. Whoops, I lost your, there we go. And have been harvesting the bottom leaves to saute with garlic. Wow, that sounds amazing. And she said abundant. So I think that's one of the things that's so rewarding about gardening is, yes, you get to have your fresh, tasty veggies, which is one of the best rewards ever, but you also get to share the abundance, like Tina just mentioned, with people. The big tomato cucumber harvest we did, we gave some to the neighbors, we gave some to our daughter and her friend. Lots of friends were able to take them home that stopped by. We were able to share a couple of meals with people, and it really, really does make it fun to share what you love to do with other people. Shelly, hi Shelly, how's it going? Great to see you. I'm harvesting basil and tomatoes. That's wonderful. Love those homegrown tomatoes, are absolutely the best. Terry's been harvesting cucumbers, tomatoes, lots of kale, and finishing up lettuce. Wow, you still have lettuce, Terry? That's amazing. I think you're more coastal than I am, so maybe you're getting some cooler temperatures. Okay, let's see. Someone is saying, Terry, figs are just about done. Wow, I'm jealous. I want to get a fig tree. So that's awesome that you have figs. I've heard fresh figs are just amazing. Tina made refrigerator jalapeno and hot banana peppers. Wow, pepper jelly are not so much. Or maybe you pickled your peppers? Okay, yeah, that's a really good way to do it too. The refrigerator recipes are super, super easy. And the healing berry has nothing to harvest? What do you mean? I've seen all that fruit you've been harvesting. The critters eat it at night. Oh my gosh, that's so discouraging. But hopefully you'll be getting some more things on. I know you got a lot of good berries and fruit coming, so hopefully you've been able to take a few of those in. So many people harvesting so much fun stuff. Harvesting, this is from Rebecca, I believe. harvesting Taiwan long beans every day. Wow, Trombuccino squash too. I've heard those are amazing and so long and so beautiful. So that sounds like a ton of fun. Harvested corn, cherry tomatoes, peppers, and chocolate mint. Oh my gosh, crazy. You guys, it's scrolling by. Everyone's harvesting so much and so excited about your harvest. So I'm so glad to hear that. It's just so rewarding to get to this point in the summer where your hard work is paying off and the garden is giving back. Isn't that amazing? Okay, so a couple little announcements here in between our tips today. First off, I wanted to let you know that the Gardening Coast to Coast podcast is in a little bit of a break, a hiatus. Just taking a break while, you know, we're doing some other projects and things like that. So you can go back and listen to all of the older episodes. I think we have around 23 episodes now. So lots out there to listen to. A lot of people really enjoy listening to that while you're out in the garden doing other things. So it's a really fun one. You can head over to gardeningcoasttocoast.net for the link, or you can get it wherever you might listen to your podcast. And also, don't forget that we are having a 20% off sale on all my seed collections, fabric containers, and signed books. So you can grab that with the code GARDENFRESH. And that sale does run for about another week or so. But go over and grab those. You get a free lettuce seed packet with your order. Pretty soon, it's going to be time to start planting lettuce again. So that'll be really nice to get your free lettuce seeds so you have some in reserve for when it's cool enough to plant in your area. Okay, let's see what else we got going here. Number three to do now in August. And I think this is so much fun because you've harvested a lot of your vegetables now. Maybe you've taken a whole bunch of tomatoes off your plant. Maybe you are cutting your herbs. Maybe you just took a whole bunch of cucumbers off your plant. Whatever the case may be, you can still possibly get another last hurrah, another round of veggies from that plant. So don't pull it out yet, okay? A lot of you northern gardeners, it might be kind of the end of some of your warm weather veggies. You might be coming into your cooler months in another month or so. So now's the time to give your plants a mid-season or an end of the season boost, whichever the case might be. For us southern gardeners, we still have probably at least two solid good months, maybe three if you live very far south, of warm weather veggies. So once you've harvested or done a heavy pruning, give your plants a mid to late season boost, so that you can get another round of veggies from that plant, okay? And a couple different ways I like to do this. We actually did a video on that as part of a watermelon video maybe a month or so ago. So look for the watermelon video where we did those sugar babies where we slung them up with like pantyhose and things like that. I talked about a mid-season boost in that video. Couple things I like to do though. Number one, keep it simple. I like to keep everything very simple. If you have compost in your garden, if you've been making your own compost, all you need to do is grab a handful of compost, walk around to your different garden beds or different plants that you want to boost, and put a little handful of compost around the base of that plant. If you've got some worm castings, I love the Vermisterra worm castings, throw that there too. If you've got some organic fertilizer, the granular organic, throw that at the base of your plant and then water it in, okay? That works really well to get fresh nutrients to your plant and to give your plant a little boost. Now, for a more immediate boost, here's what I do. I'm going to grab my favorite go-tos here. The Vermisterra Vitality, I've used this all season long with such good results. It has a natural growth hormone in it. It's all organic and it really boosts the health of your plants. It's great for seedlings. So I will water put this in my watering can. You can also use some fish fertilizer if you want some new green leafy growth, and give your plant a nice drench. You can drench that compost and those worm castings, that organic fertilizer that you just put around the base into your plant to really give it a nice boost. And a lot of times what you'll see within a few weeks of doing this is you're gonna see some new fresh green growth and new squash or cucumbers or beans coming on. The big harvest we did several weeks ago, I did this to my squash plants in the new raised bed, and would you know it, there were no squash on that plant when I give it that boost, and a few weeks later, look what I've got here. So it really, really does work. You can also use, if you've got the good dirt plant food, this is pretty handy. It is higher in nitrogen as well. So it will help you with that green leafy growth. And this is pretty cool because it has a hose end sprayer, which is so much more convenient to stick this on the end of your hose and just go around and water everything down in your garden. So this stuff works great. I've used all of these for years with really, really good results. So don't neglect that mid-season boost, because in about a month or so, you could be having a whole new round of veggies. So you're going to be really, really glad that you did that now. Okay, let me see if I forgot anything on that point here. I think that's about it. So we'll head into the chat. Well, we have one more tip to share, two more tips actually to share. But before we do that, let's see what questions are going on here. Tina, how are you, Tina? My Kentucky pole beans have a ton of flowers and no beans. Help. Okay, I would imagine your beans are not far behind because beans are grow prolifically. They grow very easily. So as long as you have some nice warm weather, just be patient, hang in there. I know it's kind of hard sometimes, but you should have some beans along very shortly. Beans are self-pollinating, so no need to go and hand pollinate all those tiny bean flowers. That would take you forever. But just hang in there, be patient, and let us know next week if you have any beans come on, okay? All right, let me scroll back through here and see what kind of questions we got in the chat. Okay, let's see here. I just planted from Root Tracker. I just planted my sugar baby watermelon. My Verma compost is almost ready to take out to use and start over again. That's awesome. And sugar babies are delicious. You're gonna love them. Hopefully you caught our harvest video on that. They're super sweet. They're a smaller, more compact variety. And if you've got maybe 70-ish days of warm weather, you can probably still get a harvest. So really depending on where you live, like Florida, Texas, the southern climates where you still have lots of warm weather. Might be a little bit late in California, but you know, why not give it a go? You only have, you're only like missing out on a few seeds if it doesn't work. So definitely northern climates would probably be a little bit late on that. Okay, let's see here. Oh, I talked about Kentucky pole beans. What's good to compost with in smaller containers? Okay, and that was from Connie Davidson. Hi, Connie, how's it going? Okay, smaller containers. You would have the same type of materials that you have in a larger container, just a smaller amount of them. And I do have a video on how to compost in a 5-gallon container. Can be done, you guys, absolutely can be done. And as a matter of fact, Smart Pots is gonna be coming out with a smaller compost sack. Their current compost sack is 100 gallons, which can be a little intimidating for some people. And hard to collect that many materials, but the 50-gallon I've been using for several months, I think it's scheduled to come out maybe next spring, I'm not sure, but it's a lot more doable. But if that's even too large, compost in just a 5-gallon container, a 5-gallon Smart Pots. And watch my video on how to do that. Just look up compost on my web, or not on my website, on the YouTube channel. You'll find a video on that. But what you really wanna do, what's key for that, is getting your compost materials as small as possible before you layer them in. So what I showed in that video how to do is to blend them up in your blender. So any of your food scraps that you have in the house, throw in your blender. If you have a good high powered blender, it'll get them almost into like a sludge or like a slurry. And then you can layer them with shredded leaves, with coffee grounds, with maybe some of your garden scraps or things like that in a small 5-gallon container. And cover it to keep, you know, everything in it, the heat in, to get it heating up just a little bit. It won't heat up a whole lot because it's kind of a little bit too small for that. But over about maybe 6 to 8 weeks, you can get compost from that. But the key is really getting those materials broken down as small as possible before you start composting. And then cover it, leave it alone, don't add anything else to it, because then you kind of start the whole process over again. Let that break down and maybe start another container with your scraps that you want to start a new container with. Okay, just saw a question here from Luz. How's it going, Luz? Can you talk about cloning tomatoes? How long to root them? When are they ready for transplant? How long before they produce? Okay, yes, you can clone tomatoes. What you wanna do is some of your really great tomato plants that you might love this year, you might wanna kind of carry them out just a little bit more into the fall, is clip a sucker, and a sucker is a little growth that's growing out of like the armpit of the tomato. So clip one of these little shoots that's growing out like that, and just clip it off at the base. You just want to put it in a jar of water. I usually root mine in the house. I like to use this as a little drop or two in the water because it helps them root faster. And after a week, maybe longer, maybe a week or two, you will see little roots coming out, usually within about a week. And it's very, very similar to how I showed how to root basil maybe a couple videos ago, I'm not sure. So once it has those roots coming out, you can pop it in a little container of soil, probably let it sit there for a couple of weeks till it gets good and established. Then you'll want to harden it back off and put it outside. As far as how long it takes to produce, it really just depends on the variety. So look up the variety that you want to clone, and it should be about that same time. So hopefully that'll help give you a little rundown on how to do that. Okay, let's move on into, we've got two more tips on what to do in August. Number four, I talked about this a little bit earlier, but it's hot right now, all right? Just about everyone is experiencing extreme heat this summer. So you want to make sure you keep up with your watering, your mulching, and your shade cloth, okay? Very important. Obviously, if it's hot and your plants dry out, they're gonna die. So really, either if you live in an area where you don't get rain, like we don't here in California, or you don't get very consistent rain, you wanna use drip irrigation if at all possible, because it just keeps it consistent. And really, when you're consistent with your watering, it makes a world of difference in your plants. You can definitely try and hand water it if you can, which will work well if you have a small area, but often it's just too hard. I mean, let's get real. We're busy, right? We work, we go to school, the kids are starting school again. There's way too much to do. So if at all possible, install drip, even if you just have a little container garden, install drip irrigation. It's going to save you so much time, so much water, and you're going to get a lot more production out of your veggies. You can hook it up to a timer to automate it, and you will just be so, it's just gonna make a world of difference in your garden. Super important. That being said, even with drip, when it gets hot, I do have to spot water at times, because maybe a container dries out a little bit too much, or maybe, you know, the day just got too hot for my hanging baskets right back here. So we've been using our hose link retractable reel like crazy lately. It makes watering fun. It's easy to pull out. If you haven't checked out HoseLink, head over to HoseLink.com and check it out. They've got retractable hoses. We have one down below. We have one up here. And it just makes watering so much easier. I think the key with watering is to make it easy. Get a watering station close to your house, a hose bib close to your house or your garden. Position it where you can easily get water to it. If you've got a hike, you know, like if your property is really big and you've got to carry buckets of water or watering cans way out to your garden, it's going to be that much harder to be productive. So the HoseLink retractable reel makes it super easy. And by the way, did you guys know they have solar lights as well? Definitely check out our video on that. It adds a lot of ambiance to your garden. So be consistent with your watering. Make it easy on yourself. Your garden will give back to you and will thank you for it as well. The other thing in the heat is make sure that you're mulching. If you have never used mulch before, I highly encourage it, especially in the heat. It really helps the moisture, keep the moisture in your soil. With the crazy drought we've had, it's really helped me to go longer in between waterings in my containers, in my garden beds, and it really does save your garden in the heat. It just provides that barrier between the sun and the soil, keeps the roots cooler. And in the winter time, it can keep the roots warmer if there's some veggies that you're still growing in the winter. So very important. I know we've talked about mulch a lot, but it's worth repeating. Fall's coming, so save those leaves that fall off your trees. That's the best thing you can do for mulch. Brings in the worms like crazy, and it's free, which we all love free, right? I'm pretty much out of leaves at this point, so I've been using a lot of the shredded straw. Many of you have asked where I get it. Epic Gardening is the best one I found. So go over and check out his website. I think it's epicgardening.com. He does frequently go out of stock, but it's great. You can carry it around the garden in little bags, and it works really, really well. Pine needles will also work well too, but get creative. And if you've got some organic matter around, you can use that as mulch. So let me know here in the chat what your favorite kind of mulch is. And if you've seen a difference in, especially the water retention here in the summertime with mulch on it. Okay, what else was I gonna say? Shade cloth, which I mentioned a little bit earlier, is you can totally use the shade cloth right now. Very important to keep an eye on your garden so it does not get stressed in the heat and overheated. Shade cloth is great. Even just umbrellas to put over your garden on a hot day or move your containers into the shade is very, very helpful as well in dealing with the heat. Okay. So we've got four tips so far, four to-dos in August, one left. Be on the alert for insects, critters, and disease. Check your garden daily for that. Make sure that you grow it, harvest it, eat it. Do your mid-season, end-of-season boost, and it's hot. Don't forget to water, mulch, and shade cloth to really help your garden be more productive here in the last official month of summer, right? Okay, let's see what's going on in your garden, how the heat is, maybe what challenges you're dealing with. And then we'll move on to our last tip for the day, okay? Squirrels in North Carolina like to shred pine cones and drop them. They think they are making mulch and helping. Wow, isn't that great? Thank you so much, squirrels, for helping out here in the garden. Squirrels are like the bane of most gardeners' existence, so maybe you can use the pine cones, right? Or the pine cone little shavings that they do to help with the mulch, which would be really nice. Hello from Pakistan. Great to have you on here, SWAT KP Life. It's awesome to talk to gardeners all over the world. It's really fun to hear what you're doing in your neck of the woods. And Tarsha is asking, is it safe to compost paper towel rolls? Yes, the brown paper towel rolls are a cardboard type of material, so you can definitely compost those. Just to make sure, if you can, that you cut them up into small pieces. Anything you can, the smaller you can get your compost materials, the better, the quicker it's gonna break down. Okay, let me move into my last what to do today, or what to do this month in August in the garden. And this is probably one of my favorite things to do in August. Hopefully it's yours too. But don't forget to get ready for fall, okay? I know it seems crazy, it's hot right now, but fall is just around the corner. Going to be nice to have the cooler months for a lot of you that have been burning up all summer long. Now is the time, guys, in most climates to start thinking and start preparing for your fall garden. Go back and watch our video from a few weeks ago on when to start your fall garden, but you're going to be really, really happy if you started now. In about 6 weeks, you'll have transplants ready to put into the garden. And let me show you what I've got going on for my fall garden so far, although I will probably plant another round. I often plant my seeds a little bit early, and sorry, I'm stepping into the sun here, but I plant my seeds early so I can get you all going on your fall garden. But this is a full tray. All of the seeds from my fall garden seed collection, I think there's 14 or 15 varieties, are started right here. There's a few more in the house. But you wanna get your cool weather veggies started, okay? These are all veggies that do well in temperatures under 80 degrees. So that being said, it's probably pretty hot right now, wherever you live, to maybe not if you're just in like the Pacific Northwest or somewhere like that where you don't get super hot temperatures. It's gonna be pretty hot to start these veggies in your garden right now. These are little lettuce seedlings, and this one is a kohlrabi. Cool weather vegetables, like 80 degrees and under. Some will even take a frost, most will take a light frost. But if you plant these outside right now, I'm getting water all over me, I just watered these. If you plant these outside right now, it's just too hot and you're gonna be discouraged, they're not gonna make it. So do yourself a favor, make it easy on yourself, because we always like to keep things really simple here, is start some seeds indoors for fall. Now, just like you would for spring, about 6 to 8 weeks, even 8 to 10 weeks before your first frost date. So for a lot of you, your first frost date might be coming up in October. Start these little seedlings indoors, so that way it saves you some time. You're gonna have transplants ready to pop out in your garden as the weather cools off, and you are gonna thank me. Believe me, trust me when I tell you to do this now, okay? It's gonna save you a lot of money, save you time, and when you grow from seed, as many of you know, it's so much fun to watch your seeds grow and nurture them, and you just get so many more interesting varieties than you can purchase when you go to the garden center. They have lots of transplants there, but often they don't have the really, like the kohlrabi. I don't think I've ever seen that as a seedling at a garden center, but you can get so many different fun varieties to plant. So in the southern climates where you don't have frost, like myself, and those of you in Florida, Texas, Arizona, usually I'll start my seeds that I'm gonna actually plant outside maybe mid-September. And prime growing season for me for cool weather veggies is in the winter time. So like November, December, January, February into March, it starts getting kind of warm. But that way you have transplants ready to put into your garden as the weather cools off. So you definitely want to grab my fall garden seed collection, 14 varieties. And really guys, when I make my seed collections, I really think of it with you in mind. What's going to be easy for you to grow? What are you going to enjoy growing? Some people, they might be starting fresh, have no idea what cool weather veggies are. So I put it all in the fall garden seed collection. So it really takes the guesswork out of it. It makes it easy for you. So if you're looking for seed collections right now, the fall garden's a great one. 14 varieties like peas, lettuce, radishes, broccoli, carrots, some herbs like dill, parsley, cool weather herbs are in here. Another good one for this time of year, if you need something else, if you're still in the heat, is these heat tolerant greens. Southern gardeners still have several months of heat left, but you don't want to be without your salad. So grab these. The cool weather, bring on the pollinators. I think I have 7 or 8 flower seed collections now. This is a good one because there are flowers that will tolerate cooler temperatures, so good to plant for fall. Then one of my favorites right now is the late summer garden seed collection. So these have quick growing veggies that are designed to give you a harvest in about 6 weeks. So if you've got 6 weeks of warm weather left, you can still get some beans, squash, cucumbers in here, I think they're nasturtiums or basil, and there's one other one. But yeah, great ones to grab this time of the year, and make sure you use that code late summer for 20% off. So let me see if I had anything else we want to share today about what to do in August. I think the biggest thing too is just make sure that you're having fun, right? Sometimes things can get discouraging when you see those pests come in, those squirrels nibbling away at your tomatoes. But just realize that's just part of it. Try and manage those expectations. Plant extra, right? Plant some backups so you do have extra plants to pop in. I just had a couple of pepper plants that bit the dust. They just weren't doing well. I don't know why, they just weren't thriving. So I pulled them out, and I did grab a couple of transplants at the garden center. There's nothing wrong with that. It's okay if you need to do that, and pop them in place because I want to have peppers throughout the winter months. So if that's what you need to do, then go do it. Don't feel guilty about it. I mean, I love starting from seed, but transplants sometimes late in the growing season are the way to go as well. But most importantly, have fun. Spend a little bit of time at the end of the day just relaxing in your garden. We've been doing that a lot lately, and it just kind of brings your day together. It gives you a few moments of peace and quiet before you head off to bed, and helps you just reflect on the day and reflect on what you're thankful for, reflect on the blessings that you have in your life, and just kind of brings the day to a really nice close in the garden. So guys, hope that list helps on what to do in the garden in August. We'll be back next Monday for another live stream at noon Pacific time and a couple of videos in between. So I hope you all have a great week. Thanks for hanging out with me today. Bye-bye.